Hi, this video is about cockpit connectivity in light aircraft. We'll focus on IFR applications in Europe, but a lot of what I talk about will be helpful under VFR and anywhere in the world. The topics I'll cover include loading databases, getting the flight plan into the avionics, sharing data between the avionics and your iPad, fuel burn, traffic, uploading weather, messaging in flight, telephony, and flight tracking. I'll be talking about various commercial products in this presentation, but you need to know that I have no commercial relationship with any manufacturer or provider. So if I tell you that I think this particular product is excellent or indeed awful, it's because I've used it as a customer and consider it so to be, not because the supplier has sponsored me or influenced me in any way. So let's look at the overall flow of information that is helpful around an IFR GA aircraft cockpit. Probably the question I hear most is, how do I get my flight plan into my navigator? Putting a flight plan into a GNS 430 or 530 or G1000 by hand is a painful experience, as every single waypoint on an airway has to be manually entered, even ones that you expect to fly straight over, because you might get a shortcut there. Entering it manually into either a GTN or an IFD is not as bad, as you can enter airway designators, each typically bringing with it maybe three or four waypoints, so the work is much reduced, but it's still a bit of a pain. You can use an SD card to send the flight plan to the GTN. So once you've made your plan on the desktop, using, for example, AutoRouter or SkyDaemon, you can export it to the SD card, putting it in a directory called FPL off the root of the card, and then import it to the GTN catalog once you get to the aircraft. Both Garmin and Avidyne have solutions to make the process much easier using either Wi-Fi or Bluetooth or a combination. With Avidyne, the capability is built into the IFD and requires no additional equipment. Garmin has the flight stream, which is wired into a panel for G1000 or GNS navigators, but is cleverly incorporated into an SD card for the GTN and its family of navigators. Once these items are installed, your iPad can directly communicate with the navigator using an app. In Avidyne's case, their own electronic flight bag. In Garmin's case, either their own app, Garmin Pilot, or, far better in most people's views, 4Flight. If you use 4Flight on your iPad to create and file the flight plan, then the process of loading it into the Garmin panel is seamless. If you use AutoRouter or SkyDaemon, then you have to export from there to either 4Flight or Garmin Pilot, and it appears in the panel. Once the app is connected, plans can be changed in the navigator or on the iPad, and the changes will be reflected in the other. Some of the same mechanisms can be used to update the database on your navigator. This works for the GTN and IFD, but not the GNS or G1000, sadly, so they still need the archaic proprietary data card. On the GTN, though sadly not the GNS, you can upload the next cycle to the navigator as soon as it's issued, and the GTN is clever enough to start using it from the effective date. 4Flight, SkyDaemon, and so on also must be updated. On 4Flight, there's just one button to be pressed, whereas on SkyDaemon, you need to follow the prompt to update the maps, but you must remember to update AIP charts and flight guides every AirRAC day. Both SkyDaemon and 4Flight can download AIP plates for their coverage area free of charge, so it's much cheaper to use AIP in places you don't travel to regularly than to get an annual Jeppesen subscription. The next bit of connectivity I'll discuss is to get your fuel state and consumption into the navigator to create a forecast of fuel and reserve on arrival. This not only saves a lot of calculation in flight, but it also provides great peace of mind as you struggle against a headwind, or indeed helps you decide to divert for fuel. In some installations, the navigator also feeds route data back to the fuel computer, so you can see the calculations on it. I love flying with this feature and really miss it on aircraft which don't have it. If used in flight plan mode, the fuel required and remaining on arrival changes as your route and the instant wind changes. Let's move on to traffic. Broadcasting your position and receiving other aircraft's position is a huge topic which could fill a whole video by itself, and maybe I'll make that video another day, but let's try to keep this simple. You might think that being able to see other traffic on your moving map is particularly helpful to aircraft in IMC. I would suggest that it's actually at its most useful in VMC. That's partly because traffic density in VMC tends to be much higher than in IMC, and while we're supposed to be able to see and avoid it, that is to seriously misunderstand the physiology of the eye and brain. It's in the nature of geometry that the aircraft that's going to collide with us is the one that stays still on the windscreen. And nature has determined that items that remain still pose no threat, so they fade from our visual cortices. That's why cats remain as still as possible as they stalk their prey. Thus, we don't see the very aircraft that are of most threat to us until they make themselves known by getting rapidly larger, by which time it may be too late. Also, collisions often occur in VMC because the structure of the aircraft gets in the way, most notably a low-wing aircraft descending on top of a high-wing aircraft. We're better protected in IMC, not only by the much lower traffic density, but also by IFR procedures. Of course, the combination can be the worst, an aircraft emerging out of IMC, for example on an instrument approach, on top of or in the path of a VFR aircraft near the cloud base. All of these things taken together mean that a knowledge of the position of aircraft around us to help us look in the right place is an important safety tool. In the States, they have a system called TISB, which gathers together the positions of all aircraft with a transponder and retransmits it as ADS-B. Unfortunately, we in Europe don't have that facility, so we are largely left with aircraft-to-aircraft peer-to-peer systems. The system which sees and calculates by triangulation the position of squawking aircraft is called TAS or TCAS-1. That sees most powered aircraft, though images of those without altitude readout aren't much use in traffic avoidance. Lighter aircraft, microlights and hang gliders are increasingly more likely to carry self-contained ADS-B transmitters, which transmits their lat long, so there's no need for complex and expensive triangulation. Gliders use a third system called FLARM, though they too are increasingly also using ADS-B. TAS receivers are built into the airframe, certified and expensive. They're also capable of picking up ADS-B. Their big advantage is that they're connected into the panel, and both squawking and ADS-B traffic will appear in the navigator, in the PFD, MFD, and if you have an iPad connected via Wi-Fi to the panel on that as well. That means that traffic and traffic warnings are displayed in your scan, and you get auditory warnings in your headset. Standalone ADS-B transceivers are much cheaper, maybe 2% of the cost of TAS, but tend to communicate only with your iPad, for example, on the Sky Demon map. This means that they're not always in your scan, especially if you're looking out, and warnings may be lost in cockpit noise if you don't have Bluetooth headphones. Some ADS-B receivers also pick up FLARM, so they see gliders too. And of course, they only pick up ADS-B, not aircraft which are only squawking, though newer transponders do also transmit an ADS-B position. Normally, the iPad connects to a Wi-Fi created by the ADS-B receiver. This creates problems if you want to go to two different types of information on your iPad, for example, Goltzer weather, which I'll be talking about in a minute, and SkyEco traffic. In that case, you either need two handheld devices or you need a unit which combines the output, like some of the more expensive Goltzers. Regarding how you broadcast your own position to other aircraft, if you have a basic transponder, whether mode Alpha, Charlie or Sierra, it will be picked up only by TAS or TCAS equipped aircraft, except where the manufacturers of ADS-B systems receive and rebroadcast as an ADS-B signal, as I described when talking about TIS-B. If you additionally have extended squitter on your transponder, easy to tell on the Garmin at switch on as to whether the letters ES appear after the product code, then your transponder is also outputting your ADS-B position, including altitude and call sign. If your transponder does not have extended squitter, then your only broadcast of your ADS-B position is from your ADS-B receiver. Although a technicality in reality, where it gets its GNSS data to calculate ADS-B position can affect how ATC deal with your ADS-B signal. Generally, the portable unit is uncertified, and therefore its GNSS position is considered to be totally unreliable and unusable, called SIL 0. But many of these units can accept a position from a certified source, normally your navigator, and this makes the position more acceptable to ATC and is usually referred to as SIL 1. The SIL value is broadcast as part of the ADS-B, and SIL 0 is normally invisible to ATC units. In my aircraft, I have both Avadyne TAS, incorporating ADS-B, and a separate ADS-B standalone receiver. It's disconcerting that the two systems very often show different contacts, with some showing up on both, but a significant number on one, but not the other. That's because the ADS-B built into the Avadyne TAS only reports some ADS-B signals. It doesn't see all portable ADS-B devices. And of course, the standalone ADS-B receiver will not see aircraft which are squawking but not broadcasting ADS-B. It doesn't need saying that neither TAS nor ADS-B in will see aircraft with no conspicuity. So for maximum security, we need all four systems, TAS or TCAS, ADS-B, radar surveillance, and our own eyes. This is too big a topic to say any more in this video. Tell me in the comments if you'd like to see a video that expands just on traffic systems. Now, weather, text, and telephony. I mention these in one breath, not because they're the same topic, because they're generally offered together in one package. In-flight weather gives you an image of rain radar, lightning strikes, infrared, winds and temperatures at different altitudes, TAFs, and METARs. Although it's extremely useful for the IFR pilot, and indeed the VFR pilot, to have a picture of where heavy rain is falling and the location of thunderstorm cells, the downloaded weather is not precise enough to use it for picking your way between the worst of the weather. This is because there's a delay between the radar picking up the weather and it being redisplayed to you. There is only one reading every 15 minutes, and it takes about 5 minutes for that reading to be processed and transmitted. That means that the image you're looking at is between 5 and 20 minutes out of date. A thunderstorm can move a long way in that time. It is possible to look at successive images and work out where you think the gaps might have moved, but that can also lead you into trouble. But it's not just rain and lightning that's useful. Being able to see the wind and temperature at different levels takes much of the guessing out of whether to change levels to improve ground speed and avoid icing. The ability to download destination and alternate METARs and TAFs is also extremely helpful in planning possible diversions. If unexpected bad weather, such as fog, affects a wide area, you can be looking for clear alternatives hours ahead of time while you still have plenty of fuel, rather than as you approach your destination. In Europe, as far as I know, there are only two contenders for in-flight weather download, Garmin's Connect system and Golzer. Both of them also offer in-flight texting. This can be extremely useful to arrange ground transportation and tell people if you're delayed. Connect also includes voice telephony. The big differences between the two systems are price, where the output is displayed, portability, and telephony. Both systems allow for the simultaneous display of traffic and weather on the same screen, but only the more expensive and capable Golzer units have this functionality. If you have a cheaper Golzer and use a separate ADS-B, I don't believe that they can be integrated on one device. So you need two iDevices, such as an iPad and an iPhone, attached to different Wi-Fis to see the outputs. If anyone knows any different, please let me know. The Garmin system is much more expensive than the Golzer. The Garmin system is built in, and by the time you've paid for installation and certification, it costs about 20 times as much as the Golzer system, which can be built in or work standalone plugged into the cigarette lighter. For that extra money, you get the weather displayed on your navigator and MFD and telephony. Golzer also costs much less to use than the monthly costs of the Garmin. The Golzer data is displayed on your iPad, either in its own app or in your moving map, such as SkyDemon. The advantage of GOLTSA being built in is that the navigator sends it to the flight plan and it uses that plan as a basis for the weather it downloads, as well as showing how the weather affects your route. But if you rent and go from aircraft to aircraft, it's very portable and works well with its own aerial. The last thing I'm going to mention briefly is tracking, enabling those on the ground to see your progress. There are three ways this can be done. It can come from the aircraft. Both Connect and GOLTSA will transmit their position on a regular basis. It can come from radar feed from air traffic control centers, which is how, for example, Autorouter does it, or it can be an interpretation of MODES transponder or ADS-B information, such as from FlightAware, Radar24, and PlaneFinder. Generally, the aircraft transmissions are most reliable, but can be lost if satellite coverage is lost, with the ATC feed being somewhat more reliable than public websites. That's all I have to say about connectivity. I hope you found it useful. See you in the next video.